Hello friends, welcome to my channel Technical Arcoin, myself Arnob Kundu. Today I will discuss on RAID, R-A-I-D. RAID stands for Redundant Array of Inexpensive or Independent Disks. So I will discuss elaborately on RAID. Okay, so go to the computer screen. Today I will discuss the topic RAID. Okay. So at first, we should know what is RAID. RAID stands for Redundant Array of Independent Disks and combines multiple hard drives together in order to improve efficiency. Okay? Depending on how our RAID is configured, it can increase our computer's speed while giving us a single drive with a huge capacity. Okay? RAIDs can also increase reliability. That means that RAID is a way of logically putting multiple disks together into a single array, right? The idea then is that these disks working together will have the speed and reliability of a more expensive disk, right? Redundant array of independent or inexpensive disks, which is known as RAID, is a technology that allows storing data across multiple hard drives. The purpose of RAID is to achieve data redundancy, to reduce data loss, and in a lot of cases, improve performance, right? Now, the exact speed and reliability we will achieve from RAID depends on the type of RAID we are using, okay? Now I talk about some history of RAID. The term RAID was invented by David Patterson, Garth A. Gibson, and Randy Katz at the University of California, Berkeley in 1987. Okay? In their June 1988 paper, A Case for Redundant Arrays of Inexpensive Disks, presented at the SIGMOD conference, they argued that the top performing mainframe disk drives of the time could be beaten on performance by an array of the inexpensive drives that had been developed for the growing personal computer market, right? Although failures would rise in proportion to the number of drives, by configuring for redundancy, the reliability of an array could far exceed that of any large single drive. Okay. Now we talk about types of RAID. At first, we talk about RAID 0, which is stripping. RAID 0 is taking any number of disks and merging them into one large volume. Okay. This will greatly increase speeds, as we are reading and writing from multiple disks at a time. An individual file can then use the speed and capacity of all the drives of the array. Okay. The downside to RAID 0, though, is that it is not redundant. The loss of any individual disk will cause complete data loss. This RAID type is very much less reliable than having a single disk. Okay. Second type, RAID 1, mirroring. While RAID 1 is capable of a much more complicated configuration, almost every use case of RAID 1 is where we have a pair of identical disks. Identically mirror or copy the data equally across the drives in the array. Okay. The point of RAID 1 is primarily for redundancy. RAID 1 also gives us the additional benefit of increased read performance, as data can be read off any of the drives in the array. Okay. Next type, RAID 5 or 6, stripping plus distributed parity. RAID 5 requires the use of at least 3 drives. Okay. RAID 6 requires at least 4 drives. Okay. It takes the idea of RAID 0 and strips data across multiple drives to increase performance, but it also adds the aspect of redundancy by distributing parity information across the disks. There are many technical resources out there on the internet that can get down into the details as to how this actually happens. But in short, with RAID 5, we can lose one disk, and with RAID 6, we can lose two disks and still maintain our operations and data. RAID 5 and 6 will give us significantly improved read performance. Okay, but write performance is largely dependent on the RAID controller used. Okay, for RAID 5 or 6, we will most certainly need a dedicated hardware controller. Okay, and the last type is RAID 10, mirroring plus stripping. RAID 10 requires at least 4 drives and is a combination of RAID 1 means mirroring and RAID 0 means stripping. This will get us both increased speed and redundancy. This is often the recommended RAID level if we are looking for speed but still need redundancy. Okay. Now we talk about RAID storage techniques. The main methods of storing data in the array are, the first part is stripping, splitting the flow of data into blocks of a certain size called block size. Then writing of these blocks across the RAID one by one. This way of data storage affects on the performance. Okay. Next type, mirroring. It is a storage technique in which the identical copies of data are stored on the RAID members simultaneously. This type of data placement affects the fault tolerance as well as the performance. And next type, parity. It is a storage technique which is utilized stripping and checksum methods. Okay. In parity technique, a certain parity function is calculated for the data blocks. If a drive fails, the missing block is recalculated from the checksum, providing the RAID fault tolerance. Okay. All the existing RAID types are based on stripping, mirroring, parity, or combination of these storage techniques. Okay. Now we talk about characteristics of RAID. Each of RAID levels has its own characteristics. Okay. And they are fault tolerance, which is the ability to survive of one or several disk failures. Okay. Next one, performance, which shows the change in the read and write speed of the entire array as compared to a single disk. And the capacity of the array, which is determined by the amount of user data that can be written to the array. The array capacity depends on the RAID level and does not always match the sum of the sizes of the RAID member disks. Okay. To calculate the capacity of the particular RAID type and a set of member disks, you can use a free online RAID calculator. Okay. Now we talk about some comparison between software RAID and hardware RAID. Okay. Software RAID is an included option in all of Statefast dedicated servers. Okay. This means there is no cost for software RAID 1 and is highly recommended if we are using local storage on a system. It is highly recommended that drives in a RAID array be of the same type and size. Software-based RAID will leverage some of the system's computing power to manage the RAID configuration. If we are looking to maximize performance of a system, such with a RAID 5 or 6 configuration, it is best to use a hardware-based RAID card when we are using standard HDDs. Okay. Now we talk about hardware RAID. Hardware-based RAID requires a dedicated controller installed in the server. Okay. Statefast engineers will be happy to provide us with recommendations regarding which hardware RAID card is best for us, that is best on what RAID configuration we want to have. A hardware based rate card does all the management to the rate arrays, okay, providing logical disks to the system with no overhead on the part of the system itself. Okay. Additionally, hardware rate can provide many different types of rate configurations simultaneously to the system. This includes providing a rate 1 array for the boot and application drive and a rate 5 array for the large storage array. Okay. Now we talk about when should we use RAID. RAID is extremely useful if uptime and availability are important to us or our business. Backups will help ensure us from a catastrophic data loss, but restoring large amount of data, like when we experience a drive failure, can take many hours to perform. Those backups could be hours or days old, costing us all the data stored or changed since the last backup. Okay, RAID allows us to weather the failure of one or more drives without data loss and in many cases without any downtime. Okay, RAID is also useful if we are having disk I/O issues where applications are waiting on the disk to perform tasks. Going with RAID will provide us additional throughput by allowing us to read and write data from multiple drives instead of a single drive. Okay. Additionally, if we go with hardware RAID, the hardware RAID card will include additional memory to be used as cache, reducing the strain put on the physical hardware and increase overall performance. Should note that we generally don't advise using a hardware RAID card for SSD volumes, as the additional cache is not necessary because of the speed of the SSDs themselves, right? Now we talk about what does RAID not do. RAID does not equate to 100% uptime. Nothing can. RAID is another tool on in the toolbox pinned to help minimize downtime and availability issues. There is still a risk of RAID card failure, though that is significantly lower than a mechanical HDD drive failure. Okay. RAID does not replace backups. Nothing can replace a well-planned and frequently tested backup implementation, right? RAID will not protect you against data corruption, human error, or security issues. Okay, while it can protect you against a drive failure,
there are innumerable
reasons for keeping backups. So don't take RAID as a replacement for backups. If we don't have backups in place, we are not ready to consider RAID as an option. Okay. Next one, RAID does not necessarily allow you to dynamically increase the size of the array. If we need more disk space, we cannot simply add another drive to the array. We are likely going to have to start from scratch, rebuilding, reformatting the array. Luckily, steadfast engineers are here to help us architect and execute whatever systems we need to keep our business running. Okay. RAID is not always the best option
for virtualization and high availability failover. Okay. In those circumstances, we will want to look at SAN solutions, which Steadfast also provides. Right.
Now we talk about how RAID works. RAID works by placing data on multiple disks and allowing input or output operations to overlap in a balanced way, improving performance, right? Because the use of multiple disks increases the mean time between failures, means MTBF. Storing data redundantly also increases fault tolerance, okay? RAID arrays appear to the operating system as a single logical drive. RAID employs the techniques of disk mirroring or disk stripping. Mirroring will copy identical data onto more than one drive. Stripping partitions helps spread data over multiple disk drives. Each drive's storage space is divided into units ranging from a sector near about 512 bytes up to several megabytes. Okay, the strips of all the disks are interleaved and addressed in order. Okay, now we talk about RAID controller. A RAID controller is a device used to manage hard disk drives in a storage array. It can be used as a level of abstraction between the OS and the physical disks, presenting groups of disks as logical units. Using a RAID controller can improve performance and help protect data in case of a crash. Okay, a RAID controller may be hardware or software based. In a hardware based RAID product, a physical controller manages the array. The controller can also be designed to support drive formats such as SATA or SCSI. A physical RAID controller can also be built into a server's motherboard. With software-based RAID, the controller uses the resources of the hardware system, such as the central processor and memory, while it performs the same functions as a hardware-based RAID controller. Software-based RAID controllers may not enable as much of a performance boost and can affect the performance of other applications on the server. Okay. If a software-based RAID implementation is not compatible with the system's boot up process and hardware-based RAID controllers are too costly, firmware or driver-based RAID is another potential option. Okay. I hope that you have understood today's topic. For more videos, keep watching my channel Technical Arcane. Thank you and bye-bye.